queries over data that wasn't perfect, data that had some uncertainty about it. Today we're going to continue that, exploring different types of query processing strategies and looking at how the way that the data is going to get used ends up influencing how you evaluate the query. So, all right, just to recap what we discussed last class, we wanted to define precisely what it meant to be processing data that wasn't precisely defined. So instead of having one precise database, we instead said that you could have multiple possible databases or possible worlds. And query processing over these multiple possible worlds would basically be like evaluating the query in each possible world in isolation. So running a query, let's call it Q, a deterministic query over that data, produces a bunch of possible results. Q of D1, Q of that was a lot more compact, this magical C table, we call it. And what you can do to the database, you can also do to a result relation. So we could take any of these query results and we could factorize those just as well. Of course, running the query in each and every single possible world was super hard because there could be a very, very large number of possible worlds. Every decision that you need to make, every tuple that could be one of two possibilities, even just one of two possibilities, introduces an exponentially growing number of possible worlds. Two choices for one tuple mean twice as many possible worlds. Two choices for each of two tuples, four. Two choices for each of three tuples, eight different possible worlds. So this could be a very, very large number. And we started talking about towards the end of class this idea of evaluating queries directly on this representation. You could take the summary representation, which is just an ordinary table, and if you did the right thing, computed things in just the right way, you could go directly from the summary representation of the database to the summary representation of the query result without having to go through this defactorization and refactorization process. So the example of that we had was a table, let's call it R, let's call it and we had name, we had zip, we had Alice, and three different possible versions of Alice's tuple. 4, 2, 1. Bob, 0, and Carol, 4, We also had town table. Yeah. Okay, so the representation, or the special representation trick that we were using was this idea of an annotation, that we could annotate every expression with a Boolean formula. And then by plugging in specific values into the formula, so for example, A equals 2, C equals 1, this gives you a specific deterministic instance, or one of those possible worlds. And what we were trying to do was come up with query evaluation semantics that mirror relational algebra in each of the possible worlds. So we realized that projection and selection were fairly simple. Projection, you need to preserve the, or bag projection, you need to preserve the annotations, but otherwise the evaluation is unchanged. Selection was completely unchanged because you don't have to make any, it doesn't interact with the annotations at all. And we realized that join, basically you create a new annotation for the result tuples by banding the expressions together. So, for example, if we wanted to do people join town, then we end up with name town with annotation. So for example, Alice. So this is basically where we left off last class. any questions up to this point? Anything that's simmering after your last class? So essentially, this expression here, if I plug in an A, if I plug in a C, and if I plug in an X, I'll get back one specific deterministic P. Okay. Let's see what happens when we start combining different operations together. So one operation that one might be interested in doing is finding out just the towns of all of the people. So for example, say I just wanted to project town off of all of that, and end up with one copy of West Amherst, one copy of East Amherst. Okay, so we have a result, and we might be interested in computing the probability of individual tuples in any of these result sets. So we talked very briefly about computing the probability of individual tuples in this table, and the observation was that the probability of this tuple, just thinking about this one tuple alone, can be derived entirely from this formula. Essentially, what we're looking for is the probability that this formula is true. We have the distribution over values of A, distribution over values of X, and the resulting probability of any configuration of those variables that leads to this being true is the probability that we're trying to compute. Now for AND, this is very easy because you're only interested in, for AND, this is very easy because you are essentially looking for all combinations where these specific parameters are true. So in other words, you're only looking to tally up the probability for all worlds where A is 2 and X is 1. So if you have a probability for A, so the probability of this one specific tuple being true is the probability of A being equal to 0.4. And times the probability of X being equal to 1, which is 0.4 also. So one specific couple being in the result set. Questions so far? These probabilities are given as input, as basically what comes from here. There's a deeper question: how does the user construct these probabilities? And if you're looking for an answer to that, I'd be happy to talk about it offline. But we're assuming for now that the user provides us, along with the input, along with these annotations, the probability of each a distribution over each of the variables that appear in the variables. Does that address your that doesn't address your question entirely, but so okay. Now this is not necessarily an interesting result over here. Because we can have a bunch of different copies of UV, we can have a bunch of different copies of West Amherst. What presumably we'd like to compute with this is not the bag projection, but the set projection. In other words, we'd like to be able to, one interesting query that we'd like to run over this is what's the probability that there is someone in West Amherst? So in other words, we'd like to figure out the probability that the distinct projection of town of people join. I would like to know what the probability is of the West Amherst couple. So let's figure that out. We've talked about projection, we've talked about selection, and we've talked about join. And in particular, this part of the query is identical to this one. So let's look at the distinct operator. So in principle, I could get any of the results in this table. So what rows should I be seeing here? Well, forget probability for the moment. So we're doing this in stages. First, we want to know what values we could get. Then we want to know what the annotations are for those values. And then we want to know what the probabilities are for those annotations. So let's start with just what values could we potentially get by taking a distinct over this in any possible point. Okay. We get West Amherst. We get East. About that. Add them. That's a good question. So, in some sense, that is precisely what we want to do. The two tuples are getting merged together, which means we want to merge their annotations together as well. So, these are our four possible values. What do we do with the annotations?
Four.
Okay. So, join combines things by and, distinct combines things by or. So what are my formulas here? When is is West Amherst in the results set. One, four, C, one. Okay. East Amherst? One or two? Two and
X is equal to one.
And X is equal to one. All right. Four.
C is one.
Okay. Same thing for Williamsville. It's two and X is one. That makes it two, excuse me. Four. C is equal to one. Probability of that. Seems a little bit weird. So what happened here? Okay. So we could take the product of so we could treat these as of A plus the probability of B is equal to the probability of A or B, but only if A and B are disjoint. In other words, if I know that A implies not B, and B implies not A. In other words, if these two sets of probabilities are completely non-overlapping, if you know that for sure, then you can add them together. On the other hand, you could also do the probability of A times, or 1 minus the probability of A times 1 minus the probability of B. 1 minus that. But this only holds if A and B are completely independent. So, in other words, got A, you've got B, A, B can be true or false, A can be true or false. And illustration, so this stems from the Markov rule, which says that the probability of A given B is always equal to the probability of B given A. So, we can simplify this slightly, or we can rewrite this slightly, and say the probability of A given the probability of B. This only works if A and B are completely independent. In other words, if probability of A given B is equal to probability of just A. So we have a bit of a problem, because this is clearly not true. The probability of our first clause is not entirely independent of the probability of the second clause, because they both share this x. Similarly, this doesn't work either because nothing in here really says that this doesn't work. Probabilities becomes a bit tricky. So there's a bunch of clever techniques that you can go through to estimate this probability. The simple trick is Monte Carlo sampling, where you basically just pick values of A, X, and C according to this probability distribution. You pick a value of A, a 30% chance of getting A's 1, 40% of A's 2, 30% of A's 3, and so forth. And you pick a bunch of samples, you see if the formula is true based on those samples, and then you tally up how many instances of true and how many instances of false you get. That can be a bit slow, but it will give you a reasonable estimate for the probability. So I want to get into one technique for estimating the probability called anytime approximation. Let's take a quick break before we get into that. Back here at 110.
Gracias.
So one other strategy for evaluating these probabilities, or more precisely, if you want to get a precise result for one of those probability values, then you actually need to construct an equivalent formula that you can use one of those two tricks. And the general technique for doing this is something called Shannon expansion. The idea, basically, is that you've got this formula, A is equal to 2, and X is equal to 1, or A is equal to C, A is equal to 1, and X is equal to 1. So you can rewrite this formula into something that does satisfy one of those constraints. And the trick is basically pick one variable. Usually you want to pick the variable that occurs the most times in the formula that you're trying to evaluate. You pick one variable, and then you create two copies of the formula. And in one copy of the formula, F, you're going, let's say we pick x, so we're going to say x is equal to 1, and f with x replaced by true everywhere, or x is equal to x replaced by 1 everywhere it occurs. Everywhere x equals 1 occurs, we're going to replace it with true. And in the second copy of the formula, we're going to take x is equal to 1, and everywhere we see that, we're going to replace it with false. So in other words, we have a bunch of clauses here, and we're going to rewrite the expression so that some of those clauses are always true and some of them are always false. So if we actually do this plugging in, we get x is equal to 1, and then in this formula, we have a is equal to 2. Plug in true for x is equal to 1, so that's or C is equal to 1, and once again, we plug in the true. We can simplify this formula a little bit and get X is equal to 1, and A is equal to 2, or C is equal to 1. The other half of this formula. So let's figure that. So x is not equal to 1. this we can also simplify to false or false, which is itself false, and false and anything is false, so we get this whole thing reduces to just false. So in other words, Shannon expansion goes from this complex formula to a slightly more complex formula, but one that the two cases are disjoint. You have the case where x is 1, the case where x is not 1. And those two cases are pretty obviously not the same, or not overlapping cases. What that means is that once you compute the probability of this formula, and you can compute the probability of this formula, probability of this formula being true and the probability of this formula being true, you can just add them together because we know that the two formulas are non-overlapping. Follow so far? More generally, so this seems like it would be really nifty. Really, really powerful technique, this idea of Shannon expansion, you can basically take any formula and you can reduce it to a bunch of completely disjoint atoms. Is there a potential problem? So if you have a million variables, then you're creating, then a million times, you're doubling the number of formulas. That's a problem. So Shannon expansion does... Basically, you stop Shannon expansion once you're down to, once you have no more variable, just one variable left, or when all of the formulas are completely disjoint. First, not disjoint, but independent. It depends on what you know about A and C. In this particular example, A and C, the distributions for A and C are independent. If they weren't, then you have to keep. In the extreme case, you just keep going until you have no variables. Like, if you don't know whether the variables are independent, then you keep going. All right. So there's one trick, there's one trick called any time approximation, where we think of the entire expression as an error structure. Or more precisely, we think of the Shannon expansion process as a sort of error structure. So let's actually here assume that A and C are correlated. So we have to go all the way to the end. So we've got a decision on X. And then, depending on X, whether X is true or false, we have to make a decision on A. And then we have to make a decision on C. So, at the very end, we end up with eight possible formulas, or eight possible leaves of this expression. Shannon expansion gets us to eight possible leaves. But remember, I mentioned you don't, so this will give you exact probabilities, but you also have techniques for getting approximate probabilities, the Monte Carlo style technique that I described earlier. So, one other strategy that you can take is to compute one level of Shannon expansion, we get down to here, and do a couple of rounds of Monte Carlo sampling here, a couple of rounds of Monte Carlo sampling on this formula. And now you have a reasonable approximation of those two formulas. Then, if you want more precise results, at some point you switch over from Monte Carlo sampling, generate another round of Shannon expansion in one of these trees. Where you pick one of these trees to expand further, and then you keep sampling. And then you do another Shannon expansion and keep sampling. And going back and forth between approximate and exact techniques, between approximate techniques and Shannon expansion, you get a progressively better estimate as you spend more time computing the results. Hence, at any point, you can stop sampling and get a reasonable approximation, not only of the probability, but some confidence bounds on that probability as well. The Monte Carlo sampling gives you an approximate probability. You still have the formula. You go back to the formula and do another round of Shannon expansion. Basically, the more time you spend doing Shannon expansion, the closer you can get to getting an exact. There's also some tricks for figuring out which the Monte Carlo sampling can also be used to figure out which disjunctive atoms have a high degree of overlap. In other words, which atoms you'd get the most benefit for doing a Shannon expansion, or which variables you get the most benefit for doing Shannon expansion. It's more of a Bay style. So this is one direction that people have been looking at in probabilistic databases. Essentially, how do you construct these annotations, and once you have these annotations, how do you reduce them to a precise confidence value? I'll show you very quick demo here. the drawbacks to probabilistic approaches is that, from my perspective, there's kind of two potential targets for these techniques. One target is statisticians, people who know what they're doing and really like working with probabilities. And it's been my observation that most people who most statisticians have their own very specific workflows, very specific pipelines, and giving them an entirely new tool is very often a non-starter. Which brings us to people who don't necessarily enjoy working with probabilities, and giving non-statisticians probability distributions or Boolean formulas and saying, here, look, we computed this for you, that also is kind of a non-starter. One trick, direction to of dealing with data uncertainty without necessarily making the probabilities explicit. Basic idea is, in a lot of cases, most of the data that you're going to be working with, or most of the data is reasonable. Or if it's not reasonable, it's at least close enough. But at the same time, there are enough errors, or there's at least the potential for errors, that you want to be able to validate, or at least make sure that the questions you're trying to ask can't be misinterpreted, or can't be errors in the data don't necessarily lead to misleading results. Isn't necessarily itself, but if the system needs to, if a probabilistic, or sorry, if the data cleaning system really, really wants to transform data in some particular way, there's this tendency in the database community to make absolutely, absolutely sure that that transformation doesn't cause data loss, doesn't break the data in any way, shape, or form. But as I'll show you in just a moment, that's not always necessarily the right thing for the system to do. So, for example, here, the ratings column, just looking at that, you can basically make a reasonable guess that the numbers there are floating point numbers. But if you actually look at the original data, there's a stray character, a typo. Some maybe this came from an Excel spreadsheet that someone accidentally hit the wrong button before loading the data in. And that sort of thing shows up all over the place. Small data entry errors, small errors that come from mistakes in how the data was logged. Even if a computer did the logging, you end up with small errors. So instead of presenting instead of simply disallowing this particular transformation, instead of saying, no, I'm sorry, I can't convert the rating column to a float because it would cause data loss, instead, one other approach to probabilistic databases or to dealing with uncertain data is to kind of hide the errors from the user. And the trick is being able to communicate the potential errors to the user. Being able to communicate the potential errors to the user outside of the query. Smaller. So if the system has to make a guess, we can keep track of these guesses and allow the user to provide some feedback about them. And use some user interface cues, like for example turning text red, in order to signal that the system had to make a guess to reach value. And the reason I'm presenting this to you is I want to talk a little bit about how these sorts of things are done. In particular, there is a question last class about. No, sorry, question this class about where the probabilities come from. I will delve into this a little bit. One particular way of getting uncertain information is when there's you know something about the data, and you know how the data is supposed to look, and the data doesn't look exactly how it's supposed to look. So we talked about constraints. Excuse me. We talked about constraints earlier in the class, and those are essentially a way of the user telling us what they're expecting out of the data. We can also infer constraints. So for example, it looks like 99% of the data has a functional dependency from one attribute to another, then there's a pretty good chance that there is actually a functional dependency between those two attributes. Similarly, if most of the data looks like a floating point number, but a couple of records don't quite line up, then there's a good chance that that's a typo. So, right. use.csv gives you a, as far as the CSV file is concerned, it essentially gives you a bunch of strings. Now, if I knew that those strings were, let's say, floating point numbers, then let's call this. If I knew that those strings were floating point numbers, what I could do is essentially project an operation in SQL systems called cast. So I could produce a representation of the data that a user might be expecting by transforming it, essentially casting the rating to a floating point number. But in order to do that, I need to actually know what type the value has. And in particular, there's every possibility that I could be wrong about the type that I make a guess about. Maybe that A3 actually makes sense as a rating. I actually do want this this cast to be as a string. The idea, one approach to constructing uncertain relations is to essentially have placeholders. So, in some sense, when I run this query, I'm not 100% certain to the value that I'm looking for. I know that this value can be, let's say, float or string. What if I just put in a variable, x? I know that x can either be float or it can be I have essentially created two possible worlds. One world where this column is a string. One world where this column is a float. They don't share the same schema, which has a few other issues, but I basically have two possible worlds. So now the trick, trying to figure out how to do query processing when you have these strange placeholders. So the idea last The idea is to create a kind of, essentially start creating new placeholders. So, the representation here starts looking like here, but on this is essentially, I'm going to use this row if x is straight, and I'm going to use this row if x is right. Questions so far? So, the problem, or there's a couple of problems here. The first is that this annotation on the entire row doesn't really give us a lot of information. Or more precisely, when we try and ask questions about the data afterwards, we want to understand, one thing, which is if we're going to do these sorts of guesses, or if we're if the database is messing with the user's data, the database had better be able to explain what it's doing. And in order for it to do that, we need a little more than just these annotations. Because if I remove the rating column, it doesn't matter what x is. These two tuples are one trick there is to move from this sort of row level representation of uncertainty to a more attribute level representation of uncertainty. That's, in other words, rather than having two separate rows for this, have kind of the same idea but at micro scale. Something like that. So we refer to this generally as attribute level uncertainty as opposed to row level uncertainty, because essentially taking the uncertainty and you're kind of compressing it down to a smaller scale. One other thing that this allows us to do is if we compute derivative values. So if we say, for example, rating times 2. So project same approach to evaluating this both on strings and on adding 2 to a multiplying a string by 2 doubles the string, multiplying a float doubles the float, and the key thing here is that the uncertainty, the impact or the influence of this variable x remains associated with the new attribute. Similarly, if I project the attribute away, just PID and count, then it literally does not matter what value this entity. Whereas if we were doing the row level uncertainty, then this would still be associated with, then these would still be associated with row level representations. So the two main benefits to attribute level annotation is that it allows us to associate the uncertainty with a specific attribute rather than with a specific row. And it also allows us to represent things more concisely. So since this is a factorized form of the already factorized representation, we're P23, the P25 that are independent are already find it. Zero. sorry, my communication is, All right, see everyone on Tuesday, we'll be doing a light review of the entire year.
Yeah.